Welcome to Small Animal Module 2. This is VOM, Small Animal Module 2, and if you're looking at this video, you've probably already taken Small Animal Module 1 from Dr. Kamens and myself. This is the material that goes along with the material for Small Animal Module 2 involving the veterinary orthopedic manipulation and also general aspects and applications to veterinary chiropractic care in general. This technique, the technique depicted in this film, is an adjunct to the materials given in VOM Small Animal Module 2 and also the text VOM Small Animal Module 2. The information applies generally to veterinary chiropractic and specifically to the veterinary orthopedic manipulation technology. Today, Dr. Kamen and I have trained over 1,600 practitioners in the United States, and we have found that close to 80% of them are applying the VOM technology, which is exciting for me. The information that you're going to see in this video is basic information that will show you things that we can't necessarily show you when we have the seminars there present and we're not able to bring animals. And some seminars are able to bring animals and some are not. And these will allow you to see other techniques that we can't cover in the actual seminar themselves. So sit back, get a beer, relax, and try to put up with me throughout this video as it is difficult to create these, and so we'll give you some more information on how to win with veterinary orthopedic manipulation and to treat cases that you haven't been able to treat before or heretofore have been untreatable. Now, gait evaluations becomes one of the more important things that we can figure out when we're trying to determine where the actual problems occur in the animal. The information that we covered in Small Animal Module 1 does not necessarily go into gait evaluation, and very quickly and easily we'll look at a typical dog, an irascible dog basically, that's running around, hopping around. The owner thinks that there's absolutely nothing wrong with this particular dog, and we'll look at various aspects of evaluating this dog's gait in an attempt to make sure that we can possibly visualize some of the potential problems this dog have. Keep in mind that the owner is very, very commonly not aware of the fact that this dog is having any problems, and of course the owners on this dog was not aware of the fact that this dog had problems that were able to be found through the VOM pass and finding this areas of a subluxation.
You want to, we can maybe walk him back and forth while he'd run. That's enough, leave it. Sit.
No, leave it.
Sit.
He's a monster dog. He's just killing monster dog.
It's important to note the way the dog sits.
Sit.
And also the dog's voluntary movement from a sitting position.
Stay. No.
This is Hudson the dog. And Hudson's how old, Mark?
Five? Six in January.
Sit. Feel. Sit. Stay.
Well trained. Neutered male. Sits relatively straight on haunches.
Stay.
This dog favors the right front leg, if you'll notice.
Sit.
He's also standing. And see? He brings up the right front leg. He has his weight on his left front leg. Tail obviously works real good.
Good.
We'll watch how this dog walks then.
No.
Notice tentative placement of the front leg. Real short placing of the left front leg as he walks. Now this is important because an animal should be walked on a short lead or short leash to be able to determine whether this dog is compromised at all. Now as you can see, this dog runs around like a crazy creature because he's just so enthusiastic he can hardly stand it. However, he is compromising his gait in the front. So this type of motion is best Notice he's still taking his weight off of his right front leg. This type of motion becomes important in evaluating a dog's gait.
No.
As he walks here, still he's floating his right front leg.
Hudson, no, come.
Now, when the dog is freely walking or trotting, sit, or running hard or fast,
heel, no.
Good.
Hudson.
Like this, this dog's ability to or compromise gait cannot be evaluated. And Hudson's playing with the stick. He's forgetting about any possible problems he may have with his motion. And he is, in fact, interested in playing. This dog will run through fire to chase the darn stick. So these dogs are hard to evaluate in this regard. They have to be walked on a short leash, and you also want to stand them up and sit them. Okay.
Good boy. It's coming. No.
Dog chose a classic flying change of leads here, like a horse, which is not a problem.
No, hut. No, come. Hut. Come.
All right.
Sit. Sit.
Watch him sit.
No. Hut. No.
Watch him sit.
Come on, sit.
As he sits standing, he always brings his right front leg up. Okay.
Drop. Drop. Stay. Good boy, come. Come. No.
Okay, as he floats his right front leg again.
Come.
Now, this could indicate that there's a problem. Now, this could indicate that there's a problem in the caudal cervical area of this dog's neck. We're going to check this dog out and see if, in fact, that is a condition. This would be a condition about C5, C6, C7, and C8, and/or T1. And so, here, a relatively healthy dog without a problem. Owner's not aware of any clinical problems whatsoever, and we're going to see what we can find with the activated device.
Okay, let's apply some advanced diagnostic techniques to Hudson the dog. Hudson is, like I said, a dog that the owner knows that there's nothing wrong with, and we can see through walking that this animal has some difficulties, probably in the C6, 7, and 8 area. So we're going to use some advanced diagnostic procedures. All the diagnostic procedures and all the treatment procedures are essentially the same type of a pulse by the activator device. So this is what we'll do, is we'll go through a diagnostic pass on the raw dog, basically, and see what happens using some advanced diagnostic procedures.
Stand?
No. When you're going to do these dogs, you basically want to put your hand up underneath their belly like this to get them to stand. Now, here's a dog that would be difficult to get to hold still, obviously. This dog wants the stick, obviously. The stick. Now, one of the restraint techniques that can be done also can be done with the owners, too.
No, no, no. Come on.
Come on.
Sit. Oh,
like
the other way.
Yeah.
Around.
I need your butt.
There you go. That's a good one.
Just support him right here.
Stop. Oh, no.
And then the owner will take, and they can take their finger, also the veterinary technician can take the finger, this finger, and bring it in underneath, in between this area here, underneath the mouth. And usually if they go over the top, like this, they're able to stabilize the dog in this fashion.
Stop.
Like this. And now this dog can't go anywhere. And you're not hurting or putting any pressure on this dog, but he isn't going to go anywhere. And the owners can usually get away with this pretty well, and so can your staff members. And here's a dog that is a case of difficulty to being able to hold still with this technique. And this would be like a very, very difficult dog, yet we'll still be able to adjust this dog adequately using the technique. So we're going to go through an adjustment on this little guy to show you how we go about doing it. But first, we're going to take this dog and switch it around. More often than not, We're interested in adjusting the dog from the dog's left side. I'm on this dog's right side, and very seldom will these dogs calm down if, in fact, you're on their right side. Now, go figure. I don't figure that out. Either maybe dogs are left-handed. So we're going to switch sides. Judy, if you would. And if you could hold on to this little dog in this regard. Now notice this dog is not moving around while I'm on this left side. What's the problem? Very good. So we're going to go through an adjustment on this little guy just to see what's going to happen. We're going to put the motion into his vertebral segment. There was no motion or no read there. Notice that you can work right up underneath the collar. And there is, in fact, a motion on his right side. He gets a read on his right rear side, I mean his right lanceolar area. Then we'll go down through here. That's a good dog. Now, you saw his ear flip back on that regard, and also you can feel his whole head shock right through at C6, C7, or C8. Let's find out where that is, because that's where his problem was. That's what we would have predicted based on the way that he was standing and walking. Okay, and that's reduced. He's got also a T8. We're going to adjust it in that regard, too. So that's a diagnostic procedure for T8. I'm on the dorsal spinous process of T1. I'm sorry, C8. I'm on the dorsal spinous process of T1, and to evaluate T8, I will fire it back towards the bladder. And I've already reduced it now with this technique. We'll go through the thoracics, looking for subluxation, and here we have a subluxation at L2. Now we're going to use a double-click technique on this dog, and they're both gone. They're both negative-negative, which means the first time we reduce it. Now, a dog that has a right atlanto-occipital subluxation and a caudal cervical subluxation in this regard, very commonly, will end up with a subluxation in the sacral area. And what happens is when I put motion into the right sacroiliac, the left leg collapses. It's okay, honey. It's okay. Come on over here. Can we give him your butt? He wants the stick.
He does.
And you don't blame him.
It's his friend.
Okay, and you can't see that, maybe you can, but when I put motion into that, his left leg collapses. So he has a right, left sacroiliac, right atlanto-occipital subluxation, and this is a very common occurrence that we see. Now, also he has a right ischial subluxation, as you notice his right leg coming forward. So we'll go back to the front part of him, and we'll finish off this adjustment phenomenon. We'll see what he's got going on his right atlanto-occipital area. Okay, we'll go through here. His real problem, as far as his anatomy, see, there's nothing there. There's nothing going on there. He's completely reduced in that regard. We'll go back down through him. Now we get a read over the right sacroiliac. Now nothing. The left ischial now reads. So we're going to go through a third time before I fall down. And he's being real patient. This would be, like I say, this would be potentially a problem dog as far as being able to adjust them. Here we're interested again in the area T7, I'm sorry, C8, nothing. And the dog still has a left sacroiliac, I'm sorry, a left ischial subluxation that's still reading. And what we'll do is we'll do a double click technique on that. And it fires off both times. That means it's chronic. That means that we've already reduced it, so we'll leave it alone. So this is how we go about taking care of this dog and evaluating this dog as far as his gait, try to look for things that we could theoretically predict that would be reads. Okay. Thanks, Hudson. Thanks, Jody. Thanks.
As you saw with Hudson, we used a double-click technique on the ischial area and also in the mid-lumbar and the mid-thoracic area. The double-click technique is a technique that determines the nature and the severity and duration of the subluxation. For instance, a negative-negative would mean that there's no read there. When it goes negative and positive, that means that that read is being suppressed by another location, and that's a very important application of the double-click technique. When it goes positive and negative, that's exactly what we'd like to see. That indicates an acute subluxation, meaning that the first pulse actually reduced the subluxation and the second pulse actually does not read. In a positive-positive situation, which we saw on Hudson's left ischial area, That indicates chronic subluxation, and that subluxation is because, and the double read is because, of the presence of the byproducts of subluxation. The byproducts of subluxation being hydrogen ion, lactic acid, bradykinins, prostaglandins, serotonin, and a number of other P substances that actually hold the subluxation phenomenon in place. Now, the presence of a positive-positive indicates a chronic subluxation, and you can whack away at that particular location the rest of the afternoon, and you're not going to get a response. Or in other words, it's not going to clear out. It'll probably clear out in anywhere from 1 to 3 days from that time period. But what you need not do is put any more motion into that joint on the double-double or the positive-positive click, because it's not going to visibly reduce during the time of that examination and the time of that orthopedic manipulation. Since some of the advanced techniques or diagnostic techniques, the first one we're going to review, of course, is the C8 adjusting technique. Actually, what we'll do is we'll use the first technique, which is the occipital techniques. And this is not adjusting the dog on the lateral wing of the atlas in the classic fashion, but rather actually going up to the dog and adjusting the dog on the occiput. So here's the wing of the atlas at this point. Bring the leg, the ear forward, and you can get right on the occiput at this level. So this is occiput adjusting, and the lateral-occipital adjusting can be very important for dogs that have seizure activity or chronic ear infections. You'll find that there'll be a read in this case. Also, all the facial nerves go through this area, and because of those, these animals are more prone to have subluxations, chronic subluxations, and inflammations in that area. When we go back to the dog, we're going to go to the C8 area, and the C8 area is adjusted. As you know, there are no 8 cervical vertebrae, but the C8 area is adjusted by palpating the dorsal aspect of the first thoracic vertebra and contacting it and then firing it towards the bladder. And this would be the line of drive for that particular technique. Beep, beep. Now we're going to do what's called the double click technique on small animal module number 1, first basic film that you all should have had and should have seen. You saw me at times adjusting animals, especially on the blue tape, you saw me adjusting animals with a double click, and you've asked me what that technique is about, and of course I deferred you to the Small Animal Module 2 tapes, which this is. And the technique involves going through and determining the nature of the subluxation, and the nature of the subluxation is determined by the first and second firing. The delay that you'll see, and then actually the timing that you'll see involved with this double click technique, will actually give us an idea of the nature of the subluxation, whether it's chronic, whether it's acute, whether it's a shadow read or what have you. So when we're going through, for instance, the dog, and then we'll find a spot, like for instance this spot, and we'll double click it. Now that would be a double negative. Negative, negative means there's nothing going on there. That is normal. The first one didn't fire, the second one didn't fire, and that's not a problem. The other technique would be, other technique would be a double, would be a negative positive in case you get this and then you get nothing. I'm sorry, you get nothing and then you get a response. That of course was a response to the third pulse. Let's try that again. That would be a negative positive. So it would be negative positive. And that one didn't read, of course. All right. The other term would be when you get a positive negative, or you have a read the first time and no read the second time. Now the read the first time would in fact mean that there's a subluxation present and that subluxation is reduced by that diagnostic read. The second read doesn't read because the subluxation is reduced. When you get a positive positive, that was a negative negative, but if you got a positive positive in that particular position, you would end up knowing that that's a chronic subluxation. Very commonly, subluxations at T13L1 will react positive-positive because they've been there for a long period of time. That is a very common chronic subluxation pattern in the canine, which is, in fact, T13L1, and will very commonly give you a positive-positive. So we've got the negative-negative, which means a normal joint. We've got a negative-positive, which means that there is a repression of that particular subluxation site, and in so making that subluxation reduced the first time, the second time it then reads, indicating that it has been suppressed in one particular location. And the third time, this third situation is in fact a positive negative, indicating that of course this is the most common, subluxation was there, and this diagnostic thrust actually reduced the subluxation. The fourth situation, a positive positive, is indicative
of a long-standing subluxation pattern, and is not going to reduce, for instance, that day, the next day, or maybe the next 2 days before that read actually reduced. And so you don't get too excited about that. Okay. Okay, now a very important thing to remember and to recognize is the presence of deep pain versus withdrawal reflex. Many practitioners, including chiropractors, have been evaluating neurologically animals by pinching the area in between the rear toes looking for upper motor neuron disease. Now, if an animal has lost deep pain, that animal is in a world of hurt. All of a sudden, the success rate for veterinary orthopedic manipulation in solving the problems and returning function goes from 91% to 93% down to 40% or less. So the presence of adequately determining whether an animal has deep pain is very, very important. Plus also, it can be easily confused with the withdrawal reflex. Now, if you take an animal and you pinch that animal on the leg with, for instance, a hemostat in between the leg area, in between the toes, for instance, the dog will very commonly withdraw that rear leg. That is called a withdrawal reflex. That reflex is, in fact, a spinal reflex, and it's a lower motor neuron phenomenon. However, if the animal has a mid-thoracic injury, serious mid-thoracic injury, and information is not able to get from the rear legs to the brain and back down to the rear legs, then the paralysis that might be ensuing would, in fact, suggest that we have an upper motor neuron problem, and the animal is unable to perceive pain. That condition, lack of deep pain, basically becomes very important because the prognosis drops well below 40%. In those cases, the owner should be well aware of the fact that that prognosis is in fact low. The important thing is that when you pinch the dog in between, or the cat, or activated other quadruped in, on the area of the rear leg, for instance, or the foreleg, and you actually put in a painful response. Now, I'm not recommending that you hurt an animal. However, you need to determine if the animal can consciously sense pain input into the brain. And so when you squeeze the animal in this regard, the animal turns around and says, "Hey, cut that out," or yips in pain. Now, here again, just enough to elicit pain. By the way, it could be a significant amount of pressure that is needed to cause the pain, to cause a pain response. You can, when you have compromised input into the brain because of a compromised lesion in the mid-thoracic area or the upper lumbar area, you can very commonly have to put a good deal of pain to the point where you blanch the tissue and even crush the tissue to some regard before you get a pain response. So don't be afraid to squeeze hard on these animals. You can even do this, by the way, with your fingernail, which is what a lot of practitioners do. And so the animal will not necessarily pull the leg back, but will respond to the pain response. Hey, cut that out. Hey, that hurts, yips in pain. The withdrawal reflex, however, that is a spinal reflex, does not indicate that deep pain has, in fact, been lost. That deep pain is either intact or not intact. So if you have a withdrawal reflex, that does not necessarily mean that deep pain is on board. So don't make the mistake between these two. Now, in the advanced diagnostic and also treatment techniques that we're going to show you in the next several minutes of this video, we're going to go through and use a C8 technique. We're going to use a caudal cervical technique at the C8 area. We're going to use an atlanto-occipital or an occipital adjusting technique. We're going to use a somatovisceral technique at about T5. We're also going to use some phalangeal and coccygeal vertebral reductions of subluxations and bat techniques. These are techniques that we have not before covered in VOM Small Animal Module 1. For instance, the first one being the occipital techniques. Now, this technique is required or actually necessary for animals with seizure activities, with chronic ear infections, with facial nerve paralyses or compromised facial nerve functions. You have dogs that have chronic glandular problems in the face, including dry eye or keratitis conjunctivesica. And the activator pulse is not on the wing of the atlas, where it ordinarily is, but rather up on the condyle of the occiput at this level. And so what you're actually doing is you're actually placing the activator device on the occiput instead of at the wing of the atlas. And that would be for the occipital techniques. Now, classically, we've shown you before the techniques that we use for adjusting C8. There is no C8, of course. And what we do see here is at this level, C8 occurs, the C8 section actually occurs in the radial, axillary, and musculoskeletal at this level here. However, what we do is we go about adjusting this animal at this level here. And here is the dorsal spinous process of T1,
and we fire it back towards the bladder. It'll either be anywhere from this angle or this angle. The section of C8 actually exists right at this level here, and actually functioning the lever of moving that back will actually put adequate motion to disabuse the animal of the subluxation at that area. Now if we count down from T1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, the area of subluxation reduction at T5 becomes very important because this area holds a lot of somatoviscceral disease. Clinically, just recently I was able to work with an animal that had chronic Cushing's or pre-Cushing's disease. The veterinarians could not determine whether the dog had Cushing's or not. Through extensive testing, we suspected that there could in fact be a subluxation occurring at T5 or 6, and this animal did have subluxations at T5 and T6, indicating that that could be a compromised input into the animal's digestive system. The dog's problem was continually vomiting, and the dog was always having problem with his serum alkaline phosphatase in the stratosphere. More on small animal module 3 will cover somatovisceral disease. As we go back further, we showed you the double click technique. We also have a coccygeal adjusting technique. Unfortunately, my poor skeleton has very little, if any, coccygeal vertebrae left. And the adjustment technique involved, it's stabilizing the joint above and below. You take the joint up, pull it back, and then fire it straight down relative to the proximal vertebral segment. So these things can all be done, and they all are done in classic fashion, as you'll see on the live dog very soon. For deep pain becomes very important if the dog has an upper spinal cord lesion or an upper motor neuron lesion. If this dog, for instance, or a dog has a condition that's causing lack of information to get from the brain to the rear leg, for instance, or the front leg, or from the brain, from the front leg to the brain, basically, we've got a major problem. So evaluation of deep pain becomes really important. Now, one should not confuse the basic spinal reflexive withdrawal. Now, in trying to evaluate a dog for an upper motor neuron problem, it becomes real important to do the deep pain test. The deep pain test evaluates this dog. A dog that has lost deep pain is a dog that A, should go to a veterinarian, or B, you should make sure that you don't recommend that this dog is going to get up and start running around within the next half hour, 45 minutes. It's a disaster case. And so you want to make sure that you know the difference between a withdrawal reflex and also deep pain reflex. If a dog's unable to get information from the rear legs to the brain or from the brain to the rear legs, the dog's going to present relatively paralyzed or flaccid paralysis and or spastic paralysis in the rear legs, and the evaluation for deep pain becomes really important. A lot of practitioners will make this mistake, is that they will pinch a dog between the rear toes and the dog will withdraw the leg. Now that's a spinal reflex that occurs at this level. And they can also have a nasty lesion that is compromising their ability to function in the mid-lumbar or mid-thoracic area, and they actually have a condition where they have no deep pain. The withdrawal reflex is a spinal reflex, a lower motor neuron reflex, and the pain reflex is an upper motor neuron reflex, the latter of which means if you've got that, you've got a major problem. So it's important not to confuse the two. For instance, when you take a dog and you take them in between the toes and you pinch them, you get that type of response. You get as you saw him beginning to pull his leg back, and then he felt the pain. Those were two reflexes on top of one another. The fact of the matter is that he will withdraw that like that, that is a withdrawal reflex. A withdrawal reflex is in fact spinal. It doesn't have anything to do with upper motor neuron. Now, let's lay him down one more time. And I apologize for this, you crazy creature.
Sit down. Sit down. That's good dog.
Now, when you continually cause him more irritation, and what you have to do, this is very commonly you do this with a hemostat, and this leg is going to be relatively flaccid if not paralyzed, and it's just going to be lying here. It may still pull away. That would in fact be a withdrawal reflex indicating a lower motor neuron problem, but it doesn't tell you anything about what's going on in the mid-thoracic area or up or above the upper motor neuron condition. And so what you do is you squeeze this with a hemostat quite hard. It would be excruciatingly uncomfortable for you and me to have that done to ourselves. And very commonly, as you squeeze harder and harder with a hemostat, you're able to produce absolutely no response. The dog just looks around like nothing's going on. Now, there may be a withdrawal reflex, but there won't be
Notice that this dog is experiencing pain, like that. Okay. And so this dog obviously is able to sense pain quite easily, and therefore this dog responds in kind and says, hey, what the heck are you doing here? So the dog is going, that has a paralyzed leg, is may withdraw their leg based on the spinal reflex, but they're not going to be aware of you actually causing physical pain to that leg. So they're just going to look around the room like nothing's happened. Okay, that's good.
Okay, now, internal Logan Basic technique is a technique that veterinarians and chiropractors can use. And Logan Basic has been used externally for a long, long time, chiropractic care. It is basically unknown to veterinary care, and it becomes very interesting, too, because veterinarians are continually putting on a glove and going in and expressing the anal sacs of dogs and cats, and also we seem to be in that orifice every once in a while. And because of that, we can utilize that exposure, or that ingress, if you will, to actually put pressure on the sacrotuberous ligament, the sacrotuberous ligament being the ligament in the area that goes from the apex of the sacrum to the lateral aspect of the caudal pelvis. We can feel that inside the rectal area and put pressure on that very adequately, a lot more effectively than we can from just the outside of the dog or the cat or the horse. And so that technique I'll describe in length. Keep in mind, however, that the animals respond to this quite favorably after they start it. You're going to provide the care, or provide the pressure, which will be about the same amount of pressure as that amount of pressure that you could put onto your eye without causing pain. And that pressure basically will first cause the dog to be uncomfortable, and then you'll start to see something occur. You'll get a muscle fasciculation, or you will get, in fact, the legs will straighten out or start to tremble, or the tail will come up. And during that period of time, you should move through until you flatten that particular response, until that hasn't occurred for at least 20 seconds, and then you can stop. Classically, anywhere from 40 seconds to 3 minutes is how long you can maintain the pressure before you get a reduction. This particular technique is used to treat conditions, and diagnose conditions, but rather treat conditions that, for instance, hip dysplasia, caudate equina syndrome, problems with the tail, and also the sacrum. The area we're trying to involve ourselves with actually involves the area of the sacrotuberous ligament, which goes from the ventral aspect or the caudal aspect of the sacrum to about this area. This is depicted, excuse me, by that rubber band. Now we have a gloved hand on, and we put our finger in, and we're able to bring our finger to bear against the sacrotuberous ligament at this point. And we put pressure on it in this regard through the rectal area. Now, we can also then turn around and do the thumb on the other side in this fashion. And so that motion is held. Now, the thing that's important is you hold a motion for a period of anywhere from 40 seconds to up to 3 minutes. And then when you're done, the actual holding of the pressure is forward and to the outside, or actually to the ipsilateral ear on that level. And so you're moving it up like this. On the inside, for instance, with your other finger, it would be moved towards this way, up, and this way. And at the very end of that, you give, the very end of it, you give it a mild thrust, a mild punch, and then you're done. The technique, like I say, is done on either side. And during that period of time, the dog muscles may fasciculate over the back, the rear legs may tremble, and the tail may come up, indicating that you do have, in fact, a subluxation involving that area, and the sacrotuberous ligament pressure, internal Logan basic check, will also allow us to be able to treat that therapeutically in that regard.
Of course, Logan College of Chiropractic does not do Logan basic checks on animals. And one of the things that we can do in the canine, also on the feline, also on the equine to some extent, but more the canine, is in fact we can apply motion to the apex of the sacrum. We can apply motion to the apex of the sacrum through the rectal area. And so very commonly we're spending a lot of time in doing these dogs, and we'll put on a glove and express their anal sacs. And we're there, we can also easily, we can easily put pressure on the caudal apex of the sacrum, and that's done in this fashion. It's almost done as though you are in fact expressing the anal sacs, but the line of drive, of course, is here. So you're going to put your hand into, I'm not going to do this on this poor dog, but you put your gloved hand, thumb in into the rectal area, and you move it up towards the base of the apex of the sacrum, and in so doing, you're able to apply pressure directly to that tissue. And then at the end of that motion, good dog, At the end of that motion, when you're in there like that, you'll apply a motion, a little pulse up into either the left side or the right side. Now that's, you're doing it, if you're on the left side of the dog, and most of the time you're doing it with your right hand, and so you're in there like this, and you're pushing up in that regard, and then you can also do the same thing with your finger on the other side, and the motion is you have a hold of the tail, you have a hold of the tail, and you're going to take your finger, bring it in, and put it on the apex of the sacrum, and you're going to push on it, and then push it up and to the left at the end of it. It may take anywhere from 30 to 40 seconds, and one of the things that you'll see as you do this, the dog will start to move around the rear legs, and then will then calm down. The dog will just calm down as you continue that pressure. You may also see some muscle fasciculation over the butt area and also the leg area as the dog calms down. Very commonly, the dog, at the end of the adjustment, internal Logan basic adjustment, will sit down or want to try to sit down. Also, as we go through the internal Logan basic technique, the dog's legs may straight out, and he may stick his butt up in the air, indicating you're not done completely. However, over 40 seconds is too long. You usually don't have to do it more than 40 seconds. Okay. Okay, there's...
Now, the advanced treatment techniques that we're going to show you on Hudson are techniques that we apply in VOM passes every day. However, their application becomes important because they're linked to specific diseases that we heretofore really haven't addressed exactly in Small Animal Module 1. For instance, when we do occipital technique, as I mentioned before, the occipital technique basically directs ourselves to conditions that we heretofore haven't treated, such as seizure activities, chronic ear infections, situations involving facial paralyses, and lack of production of the glands of the face, including dry eye and a number of other conditions. As we move back to the C8 adjusting techniques, as we're working in the dorsal aspect of T1, introducing motion to C8, now this is C5, 6, 7, and 8, we see conditions such as avulsion of the brachial plexus, which is listed on Small Animal Module 1. We see conditions of shifting foreleg lameness, and also a canine wobbler syndrome, a heretofore not very well treatable disease condition, only treated with surgery, easily treated with the VOM technology. One comment about the shifting foreleg lameness, it's very, very common that veterinarians will see a dog that will come in and the dog will basically be having difficulties with one of its front legs. They'll x-ray the whole dog, the whole leg, and not find any radiographic signs. Our diagnosis is going to then be soft tissue injury, and we place the animal on medications, Rimadyl, non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, or cross your fingers, or rest. Now, the owner will then come back after that's taken care of, point at the same, at a different leg and say, yeah, that leg is still lame. Can you see, Doc? It's that left leg right there. And they'll take their left arm and they'll point right at what they think the dog's left leg is, which in fact is the right leg, and you've been looking at the left leg. And you go through and x-ray that and find out that there's nothing wrong with that. Send the animal home on the same medications. 3 weeks later, the dog will come back, and the other leg is, of course, lame now, too. So this shifting foreleg lameness is almost always held in place by subluxations at C8 and C7 and C6. And this avulsion of the brachial plexus is very common for this condition. And Hudson, the dog that we're adjusting right now, has this condition, intermittent foreleg lameness, front legs favoring. As you noticed in the previous information, he was floating that right front leg. And he will also compromise his left front leg back and forth and back and forth. So these techniques are used specifically for this dog and for other dogs. Now, when we're treating the area in T5 as T6, like the Cushing's disease dog I told you, or the so-called Cushing's disease dog I told you about before, this is a dog that has a reading pattern there. It's imperative to note this. There will be no anatomical subluxation sign at this level. There won't be a deviated vertebral segment. There won't be a dorsal spinous process that's off to its side. There is no listing for this disease subluxation. So if you use a listings-directed means to which you determine whether or not an animal is in or out of adjustment, you will miss this case every single solitary time. Keep in mind, very important, that only 40% of the subluxations present in the animal's body will actually, in fact, have an anatomical subluxation sign or a listing that you can delineate whether or not there in fact is on board a subluxation. Therefore, you're going to miss about 60% of them. And if that's the situation, you're not going to get the product of the reduction of subluxations, all the subluxations in the animal reduced, which is what the product is. Until we reduce all the subluxations in the animal's body, we can't hope or even help, we can't at all help or hope to get the animals better, because its conditions are going to be held in place by subluxation at another level. When we move back and we endeavor to try to adjust the sacrum with the internal Logan basic technique, this can give us a reduction of a number of different types of conditions that are secondary or compensatory to primary subluxations in the axial spine. I don't use internal Logan basic very much because basically it is adjusting the vertebral segments past L7, and at that level everything else seems to be compensatory. In fact, everything beyond the end of the spinal cord, which ends at L4 or 5, seems to be compensatory, and it's held in place by something higher up on the axial spine, which becomes very important. As far as reductions of coccygeal vertebra, basically, and also of interphalangeal and intermetatarsal and intermetacarpal adjustments, they all involve a very basic approach, which involves stabilizing the joint proximal, and then you lift the joint distal, extract and lift the joint, and then bring the joint down. This can be done manually, or it can be done with the activator device, where you stabilize the joint proximal, you lift the joint distal, and in so lifting, then you put your activator device on the proximal aspect of the distal segment and fire it down. As far as what it looks like, is you have stabilization upstream, you lift the downstream and extract it, and then you bring it back down quickly. You can do this manually also on the coccyx and on the phalangeal joints. And sometimes you will hear a nice nifty little release, such as a click. However, if you use the activator device, which is what I recommend, you won't hear the click because it will be superimposed by the activator device's actual clicking sound. So we're going to go on and we're going to go through some activator advanced treatment techniques on Hudson the dog, if he cooperates.
Different. All right. There are a number of different techniques that we use that are advanced techniques in VOM Small Animal Module 2. One of which is the occipital technique, the atlanto-occipital technique, where we actually contact the condyle and our, the mastoid process of the occiput. And what we do is we'll take the ear, move it forward. Did you pull it forward? And we're actually going to contact this area right here and fire it off and do the same thing on the other side. Now, this will take the place of the wing of the atlas adjustment, and also you will finish that off by going to the dorsal aspect of C2 in this regard. Other adjustments that we see in the advanced technique in the parietal cervical and the anterior cervical is actually a ventral adjusting of C2 and C3. And this is done from the right side because the esophagus comes down the left, the trachea comes down the left. And what you're doing is you're going in underneath and actually getting up onto the longissimus muscle, the muscles that are underneath, in fact, the spinal vertebral column, and you fire it in through there. So you're displacing the trachea and the esophagus to the left side. And you're actually firing in underneath that. And when the dog's head is a little straighter, you can actually get all the way up into that area. Now, you're also going to be right on the carotid artery, but that's not going to compromise this dog whatsoever. You can do the same thing now for caudal cervical technique, and whether you go in on the left side or the right side doesn't make a whole lot of difference, just however you can get in there. But you can get right into it. As you put your finger into this area, you can feel the ventral aspect of the caudal cervical vertebra, and you can come around and you can displace the trachea and the esophagus and fire it right in that fashion, like this. Okay, good.
There you go. That's a good dog.
Now, the other techniques that we see in the canine of the advanced techniques, of course, is also a diagnostic technique, which is the C8 technique, where we're at the dorsal process of T1, and we fire towards the bladder. And then you should always check T5, another advanced technique, in looking for T5 subluxation, indicating a potential gastrointestinal or somatovisceral disease that we see with dogs with a number of other types of problems. As we go down there, of course, the double click technique is also a means by which we can adjust, and that's another one. But one of the other techniques that we use, and we use quite a little bit, especially if we have difficulties in adjusting the sacrum, is in fact the adjustment of the sacroiliac with leg extension, and it looks like this. You take the leg in extension, get him to relax, and fire it like that. Okay, good dog. Now, a lot of dogs, Hudson's a real good example of a dog, because here he's hopping around quite a little bit. He's a challenge to adjust, but you can still even adjust these dogs without a problem. You can adjust the sacrum in classic fashion from the left side, or the right side, or in the center, but the line of drive is towards the bladder, again, or also ventral. And we can also adjust, when you make an adjustment to the sacrum, you always need to back it up with adjustment at the sacroiliac, I'm sorry, at the ischial area on either side. Click. Click. Okay, so that's good. Okay, so another advanced technique for adjusting will be the transverse processes. The transverse processes are hard to get onto at this level, which is L1, 2, and 3. But L3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, the transverse processes will set out about that far. And if you feel down and you feel the dorsal spinous process deviated from one side to another, we can get a good moment or a leverage by moving the transverse process of the lumbar vertebra. This is only good on the lumbar vertebra. Now, this is not the mammillary processes, this is the transverse processes. And they exist, refer to your anatomy, they exist just a little bit off the center. And so what we'll do is we'll find the center, we'll find the one that's deviated, for instance, to that direction, and we've been having troubles bringing it back with just an adjustment. So what we'll do is we'll go off and a little bit anterior to the dorsal spinous process of that vertebra. We'll contact the transverse process.
Come here, honey.
Good dog. We'll contact the dorsal transverse process. Let's do it on the other side. And we'll fire like that. So here's the dorsal process of 3, for instance. And so we're going a little bit anterior and down and right on top of that. And I can fire it off that way. Of course, he doesn't have any pathology there, so he doesn't respond. So that would be the transverse process contact. Now, there's one other technique that I'll show you, too, and that's coccygeal adjusting. Very seldom do we actually have to adjust the coccygeal vertebra because they're basically compensatory to every other problem in the animal's body. The same thing with the sacrum. However, the adjustment for the coccygeal vertebra or the tail involves basically traction, elevation, and once that elevated, then you're able to contact the dorsal spinous process of the vertebra that you've got a hold of. And so you bring it up, you pull it back, rather bring it up, and then you're able to put it back into place. And he doesn't like to have his tail touched, as you can see, because in docking this dog's tail, they've basically compromised all of the compromised all the nerves and also all the muscles that continue down the length of this dog's tail. And that means that these dogs are commonly subluxated in their tails. And that can extend itself into the sacroiliac joint on either side. And also can subluxate compensatorily, can subluxate the sacrum. So very commonly, dogs that have tail docks have tails that are subluxated. Whether or not they cause disease condition or not, that is secondary to this problem, kind of depends on each particular case. But the adjustment is up, pull, and then as you're extending, pulling the tail and lifting it up lightly, and this would be about 3 or 4 pounds worth of tension, you'd fire it down. And as you can see, the response is significantly different the second time because they're easy to put back in. As you can also see, when this dog sits, this little dog sits down and has a lot of trauma that goes to that tail. It gets jammed all the time. So the tail in these dogs are continually subluxated, which produces other types of problems. Okay.
In the last 8.5 months, I've trained over 1,600 practitioners across the United States with the help of Dr. Daniel Kamen. One of the questions that most people have asked us continually is, what about periphery adjusting? Now, periphery adjusting is also done in activator methods technique. And it's important to understand that this technique does not in any way, shape, or form emulate or follow activator methods technique developed by Dr. Arlen Fuhr in Phoenix, Arizona. So it's important to note that we've been asked continually about peripheral adjusting and extremity adjusting techniques. Now, the nature of the application of the activator device, or the devices we'll continue to call it, has been on the axial spine, and the contact point has almost always been the dorsal spinous process of the actual axial spine. However, we can also adjust animals that have problems of compromised input into the dorsal horn
from a peripheral nature or from the extremity nature. And it's important to understand the pathophysiology of actually adjusting extremities. It is, for the intents of all intents and purposes of the VOM technology, no different from applying mechanoreceptor input into the dorsal horn through motion on the dorsal spinous process. Here again, the way that we reduce via presynaptic inhibition the phenomenon that's occurring at the interneuron level in the spine, spinal vertebral segment, is in fact by applying mechanoreceptor input into the dorsal horn. And that can be done by motion to the dorsal spinous process, or it can be done by providing mechanoreceptor input into the peripheral nerves at the joint level. Herein lies the technique of extremity adjusting, and we'll do the foreleg first, and then we'll do, I'm sorry, the hind leg first, and then we'll do the foreleg. But first we want to review the neuroanatomy to some degree. Now in your notes you have this diagram. These are in your notes in small animal module 1. But it indicates that the various areas of the pelvic limb at L4, 5, 6, and 7, these segments then become the femoral, obturator, cranial gluteal, caudal gluteal, sciatic nerves independently, and also the pudendal nerve coming off at S1, 2, and 3. And this is where they exit the spinal canal at the intervertebral foramina, and at that level we can theoretically make some reductions of subluxations therein. But all of these nerves basically input into these levels at which the interneurons may be present at the various level, or they may be further up, and we can adjust them further up and still affect that, or we can adjust the peripheral nerve, and in so adjusting the peripheral nerve we can then provide mechanoreceptor input into the dorsal horn and reduce the subluxation at the interneuron level. In the foreleg, we have the same problem, same situation. At C6, C7, and C8, remember that's just caudal to C7, just behind the seventh cervical vertebra, T1, T2, we have the inputs of the suprascapular, subscapular, musculocutaneous, axillary, radial, median, and ulnar nerves, all of which input into that area. Mechanoreceptor input from these areas into these nerves will go directly then into the dorsal horn and then up or down the vertebral segment, almost always up, and that produces, they interface onto the interneurons, and the interneurons then in fact allow mechanoreceptor input to close down the pain gate through presynaptic inhibition and stop the subluxation phenomenon. Now, here is a cross-section of the vertebral section, of a vertebral section, indicating we have the dorsal horn and the ventral horn. We have efferents out, afferents in. However, what happens is as we extend out to the target organ, in this case a muscle or a joint, for instance, input anywhere along the afferent input into the dorsal horn, as long as it's mechanoreceptor input, will provide, in fact, mechanoreceptor input into the dorsal horn, which will then interface on the interneurons, which are not depicted here, either up or down the spinal segment, and basically allow the subluxation process that's being held in place to be disabused and therefore restore communication ability and function to that particular segment, the motor unit. The mechanoreceptor input then going into the dorsal horn, afferent horn, the dorsal afferent input into the spinal cord, and therefore a peripheral adjustment has the same effect as the effect of adjusting right across the dorsal spinous process of each and every vertebral segment. Now this becomes important when we're trying to deal with disease conditions such as anterior cruciate rupture, medial collateral ligament rupture, medial patellar luxation, problems of the hock and stifle, problems of the hip. We'll go into that in detail in a peripheral adjusting. Peripheral adjusting can be used in an adjunct to axial adjusting, and it's not to be able to replace axial adjusting. An important concept to remember here is that when we have subluxations, they occur at the segment and not at the vertebral area. Now, we're able to count the vertebra, and we're able to indicate that that's where we get reads. But it's important to understand, for instance, that here we have C8, but it's existing right over C7. And here we have C7 that's existing over C6 as far as the intervertebral segment, the segment actually that involves the motor unit. So they're not directly related to the vertebra that they're involved in. For instance, we have segment number 8 over vertebra number 7, for instance. And that continues all along the back here to where we see the lumbosacral plexus usually occurs at L4, 5, and 6.
that occurs over L4-5. And this is why, in this area particularly here at L4-5, that we get all of these particular segments crammed into the L4-5 area. As you recall from Small Animal Module 1, the subluxation, the answer to just about every question was L4-5. Well, this is why L4-5, because all of these segments are basically jammed into this area at L4-5. So if you wonder why L4-5 is always reading and always holding in place pathology, it's because of this phenomenon right here.
Now here we have Hudson, and we're going to consider periphery adjusting or extremity adjusting. We're going to adjust off the spinal nerve column. We're going to adjust off the spine, and we're going to adjust basically the inputs into the spine by adjusting the problems or pathology associated with subluxations from successive joints. We'll do the hind leg first. In the hind leg, we first go after the coxofemoral joint or the hip. The contact point is going to be the greater trochanter, which of course is the big lump that we can palpate by moving this dog's leg, and it's right here in this guy. We can move his leg around and we can feel the greater trochanter. And so we're going to take care of that. And we're going to contact this point, and the line of drive is towards the contralateral knee. So if this dog, for instance, has a hip problem, a unilateral or bilateral hip problem, or hip dysplasia, or a chronic arthritic condition that's holding or freezing up that joint, you can manipulate this dog peripherally by adjusting on the greater trochanter contralateral to the other stifle. In other words, the line of drive is towards the stifle. And it looks like this.
Good dog.
It looks like this. Okay. Now, you want to make sure that you're not far back on the leg, because if you get back towards this area here, you're going to be firing right on this dog's sciatic nerve. If you're right here, you're right on the dog's sciatic nerve. That's a problem, because his leg is going to go flying. You're not going to do a whole lot of good. You could actually, in fact, do some harm. I've always said that there's no way that you can harm an animal with an activator device. However, if you whack him on the sciatic nerve, you're going to screw him up. So don't get in this nerve area. It's right up in between the muscle belly here and the semimembranosus, semitendinosus muscle. It lies right in this area here. But the greater trochanter is right here, easy to palpate. You can fire it this way. Another way to fire it also in some dogs is to fire it anterior to the anterior cranial area towards the caudal area. You can palpate it right here. It's very easy to find. It's a big bump sticking out there the way this dog is standing. It's very easy to palpate. You can hook on it and fire it ventral lateral. This is another way it means to take care of it. Now, it doesn't hurt him, it kind of scares him. Anytime these dogs are moved on a spinal level or on an extremity level through the bone, it kind of shakes them up a little bit, but there's no pain involved here. Okay, that's fine. Okay, so as far as going down the rest of the hind leg, we're going to now try to adjust the stifle. Anterior cruciate rupture and mediopatellar luxation are probably the most common disease conditions that we see in veterinary medicine as an orthopedic disease condition. These dogs, as you know, always have L4-5 subluxations, but they can also be reduced, and you can also induce the subluxation that maintains itself at the L4-5 level by actually adjusting the peripheral nerve through adjusting the extremity. And so in adjusting the stifle, you've got three different potential points to hit, and you should hit all three of them. One of them is the classic straight patellar tendon. You pick the leg up. You're going to find the patellar tendon, and you're going to fire on it like that. Okay. And as you can see, the dog flexes, and it indicates not that there's subluxation involved there, but rather the dog's patellar, straight patellar reflex is being fashioned. But in firing off that reflex, you're going to reduce subluxations as input to the dorsal horn will reduce the subluxation. Now, the other approach to taking care of the stifle is to fire down the length of the stifle. Relax. That's a good dog. And what you do is you flex the dog's leg, you find the patella, which is right here. You hook on the side of the patella, which is right here. It's somewhat difficult to do. And fire down the length of the tibia. So you're flexing the leg. You want the dog reasonably relaxed. And you're going to find the patella and fire down the length of the tibia, which is the second way. Now, the third way that you have to, and you do have to do all three of these to adjust the knee, is you have to come back and adjust the lateral aspect of the dorsal process of the fibula. And that's going to be right at this location here. The dog doesn't have to be standing, or could even be lying down. By the way, all this can be done lying down. And you can feel the fibula come up. Make sure that you're not getting the lateral epicondyle of the of the femur, but rather the tibia. So here's a lateral epicondyle of the femur, and here is the dorsal spinous process of the lateral aspect of the fibula, and you put the device there and fire it there too. So that those three situations is how you go about adjusting the stifle. So in adjusting the hock joint, the tibial talus joint, what we'll do is we can use the technique that Dr. Kamen has used, called what he calls a hock rattle, which is basically picking the leg up, getting it flexed, and then basically shaking it back and forth. And actually what you're doing is you're flexing it like this, or sometimes you can flex it like that. And that is enough adjustment input into that. That type of motion is unusual for the canine because it's usually flexed. So you pick it up and you can do this. When you're actually bending the hock in this fashion, if you extend it a little bit and bend it a little bit more, you get a little bit more motion. Now, you can also adjust the hock in three other ways too. You can do it on the lateral malleolus. And by the way, this technique is all three are required. The lateral malleolus is easily palpated at this level. It's a big lump on the side there, and your adjustment technique is from the lateral side, like this, click. And then the final adjustment technique is down the length of the olecranon. The olecranon here, basically the lump that's going there, and this is an easy one to do, and you fire it off in that fashion. Also, these dogs can have their phalangeal joints adjusted too, and what you do is you pick the joint up, like the tail, pick it up, extract it rather, pick it up, and then you adjust proximal to that. So let me show you how that goes. By the way, it's very difficult to do the dog unless the dog's lying on the side for that particular condition. But you pick the dog's leg up. That's a good dog. Pick the leg up, you pull it, extend it, and then fire it. And this can relocate dislocated toes and also take care of toes that are chronically twisting one way or another, or even toenails that are growing in completely wacky. Those ones can be usually have subluxations involved.
One of the last things that we'll handle today would be extremity adjusting of the foreleg. We'll go through this, and indications for such adjusting would be the intermittent foreleg lameness, the dog that has a problem with the front leg that can't be shown on x-ray. Virtually every veterinarian across the country is plagued by the dog that has intermittent lameness or some lameness referable to the foreleg, and they can't find anything wrong with the paw, the carpus, the elbow looks fine, radiographically it's fine, the shoulder looks fine. The diagnosis is soft tissue injury. In those pets, before they're placed on non-steroidal anti-inflammatories or anti-inflammatories of any kind, one should investigate the areas from C3 through T1 and T2, and also make sure that a routine peripheral adjustment or extremity adjustment is placed in on this dog, and then you stand back and see how the animal is going to respond before we place the dog on ameliorating anti-inflammatories and non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, which will just mask the symptoms. So this will be extremity adjusting for the foreleg on our recalcitrant or reluctant Hudson the Wonder Dog.
Adjusting the foreleg, extremity adjusting the foreleg is particularly easy too. Adjusting the shoulder can be done through scapular techniques and also through a number of other techniques, but the shoulder is basically adjusted at the greater tubercle of the humerus. And here is in fact the acromion spine at this level. You can palpate down the scapula to the acromion spine, and then you go right to the greater tubercle, which exists at this level right here. And the line of adjustment, as you hook that greater tubercle, here is the spine, here's the greater tubercle, is towards the contralateral elbow. So you're firing like this, kind of a little bit back towards the other elbow. And that will adjust that particular joint of the shoulder. Okay. Now if we go down the leg, and we go to the elbow is an interesting joint. It's probably the only true joint that is in fact a hinge joint in the animal's body. The chances that it's going to be subluxated is kind of slim. However, there's a lot of pathology involving medial coronoid process, ununited medial coronoid process, and ununited and canal process. And there can be subluxations in conditions that are going on there, and their reduction in fact allows them to heal much faster. And so the technique in the elbow is very similar to the technique in the stifle. Your lines of drive is going to be down the olecranon, and I have the olecranon at this point, and I'm going to go down the length of the olecranon. That's a drive point. Then there's the lateral aspect of the radius on the proximal end, and you're going to go medial to that. And those are the only two adjustments that we need to fool around with. Very commonly, if you go on the medial side and adjust the medial aspect of the radius in this regard, you're going to hit his funny bone nerve, if you will. And that median nerve and artery basically will fire off, the ulnar nerve rather too, will fire that off, and the dog's leg will be numb for a few minutes. And you can end up making a dog look like you've harmed him if you go on the medial side. My recommendation is not to go on the medial side. As we go down to the carpus can be adjusted with a technique very similar to the tail extraction, elevation, and adjustment technique, or it can be adjusted as easily. Carpus is easy to adjust, is by going on the radial carpal nerve, the radial carpal bone, the ulnar carpal bone, and on either side. So you can adjust the dog like this and like this, and you can also adjust the dog in extension. However, if you overextend the dog's when the elbow is bent, you can cause some difficulty and some pain. However, both techniques should be done. You should do the dog when the dog's leg is flexed. When the dog's carpus is flexed, you should do the dog like this, both radius and ulnar carpal bone, and then extend them and do radius and ulnar carpal bones. As far as the interphalangeal adjustments for the forelegs are the same as the rear legs, which involve traction, elevation, and then adjusting the proximal vertebral segment.
So, thank you for sitting through this video, Small Animal Module 2, video that's an adjunct to the data that you see on Small Animal Module 2. I appreciate your patience, and also I'd like to make a special plea for those of you who are not using actively the information that you gleaned off of Small Animal Module 1. For the chiropractors, you should all be out there and you should be inducing your veterinary affiliates to use and apply this technique and your technical ability using the VOM practice to diagnose and treat cases that heretofore have not been able to treat before. And for the veterinarians who have the data, who let it sit on the shelf for all this period of time, shame on you. You should be out there and you should be applying this, because by the application of this technology, you're able to treat disease phenomena that have never been treated before, and also diagnose conditions that have never been diagnosed before in this fashion. 15, 16 years ago, I started to realize that there were a huge amount of cases that were out there held in place by subluxation. And only 15 years later now are people starting to say, hey, I guess there is in fact a phenomenon called subluxation, and I guess it does hold disease conditions in place. After you embrace the phenomenon of neurological subluxation sign as an evidence of subluxation and subluxation compromising input into the dorsal horn, therefore compromising neurological function, then restoration of that neurological function can virtually treat almost anything that occurs in veterinary medicine. Now, for instance, cases like the so-called Cushing's disease, I'm not suggesting that this particular input can cure Cushing's disease. However, the Cushing's disease-like syndrome that is actually just impaired gut function is really not Cushing's disease and basically has its presence in subluxations at T5 and T6. Other situations of that same like are basically replete in the canine, the feline, and the equine. And it's only a matter of time before practitioners like yourself and like myself are able to elucidate these and provide these to our colleagues and allow us better able to reduce clinical suffering and clinical disease in the domestic canine and also non-domestic animals, and domestic quadrupeds in general, and solve disease conditions we've heretofore only dreamed about being able to take care of. Thanks again very much for your time and your patience, keeping in mind that we could create a really slick video in this regard, like the ones that we get from our manufacturers. However, to do that, the videos themselves would cost you about $168, which is probably going to be more than the seminar put together. So, if you will be very much aware of the fact that this is Small Animal Module 2, associated with this module is an advanced clinical applications and case studies video, which I think is marvelous. It's about 100 times better than the first one that you got, the infamous blue tape. And this tape will be available soon. And it's basically clinical cases that are directed out using advanced techniques and a lot higher quality and ability to detect these subluxation phenomena in these animals. Also, this is Small Animal Module 2 out of 3 and 4 Small Animal Modules, where 1, 2, and 3 are required for certification. This will be a certified veterinary chiropractitioner, of which
we basically recognize. At this point in the United States, no certification course is recognized by the American Veterinary Medical Association, and hopefully before the turn of the century, the Certified Veterinary Chiropractitioner and International Association of Veterinary Chiropractitioners will have put enough pressure onto the AVMA to cause it to be recognized. So again, thank you for your patience, and have a great day.